hello, everyone. Welcome from all around the world, into Nepal, into this fabulous exhibition of ours, the Art of Jean Vendome. This exhibition was carefully curated by something in San Francisco School with 126 intermediate pieces from 26 different collectors. You know, not only is this exhibition collected for such a special event, a special virtual event, or sometimes they have you all with us virtually, but also in different museums around the world, you can see Jean Vendome's art exhibit. The Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, the Museum of Decorative Arts here in Paris, we have a piece from the Museum of Decorative Arts right here, a gorgeous piece that you can see online for now. And even the Glasgow Museum in Glasgow, the Gold is called the Museum of Decorative Arts, and other museums too. Now, we're very happy to have you virtually tonight. We're very happy to, we appreciate you welcoming us into your living rooms and your homes wherever you are, because we're looking forward to being able to open the doors of this exhibition again. Right now, of course, the doors are closed. But breaking news, folks, the exhibition has been extended to May 8th. So we can keep our fingers crossed, and we can hope, can't we? Meanwhile, I'm enjoying it tonight with my friend and colleague and teacher at Nicole, Paul Paladin. And come and join us on our website. We'll give you plenty of chance to find everything on our website. There is a gorgeous virtual gallery with the pieces. There are these incredible little videos made by the experts, thanks to the Beaux Arts Magazine partnership. There are all different ways, virtual tours, and walk photos, all different ways to enjoy this virtual experience and keep it going after tonight with Paul. Right now, are you ready for me to go? Paul?
Hello. Hello, Inezita. Thank you for today's meeting. I'm happy to be back, and we're so thrilled to welcome you to this beautiful exhibition of your friend. We just wanted to tell you a few of one or two details about the housekeeping, and also to tell you our friend and colleague, Inezita Eckel. He's an art historian and also a teacher at the Gay-Eckel School of Jewelry Arts. He's on modulator tonight, so you probably already saw it. He's probably been traveling with you. And he will also help you collect your questions. If you could try to put your questions more in the Q&A than in the chat, it would make it easier. And at the end, he will send them to us. And don't worry so much about the link and the bibliography, et cetera. Don't try to take it. You don't have to. We're going to send it to you after the talk. So without further ado,
here we are with our poster for the exhibition and our news flash band saying, till May 8th. We're so excited about that. Fingers and toes crossed. Tonight, as you know, welcome back. Many of you, I hope, new folks joining us, and also our friends and students who are now members of this club, this cultural hub that we call the Students with Jewelry Lovers. We divide our hour into three chapters. Tonight, it's training and encounters, it's the worlds of Jean Vendome, and then the whole thing is
creativity. You're going to understand tonight that Jean Vendome is a visionary. He frees himself from the constraints of history, of jewelry, but always respecting all technical skills, and design. And by the end of tonight, this little short hour, we hope that you will admire him as much as we do.
I think we have a lot of his fans joining us too. New fans, old fans, timeless fans. How did it all begin? It all began, Jean Vendome is with us because his parents, with suitcase to their name, nothing, they left everything behind because of the war, Armenians were in France in a refugee camp in little wooden shacks, Terry, his son tells us. And they met there, they fell in love. In fact, for their first date, Jean's dad brought fruit and food and on his bicycle, and the first time that his mom had ever tasted a banana was thanks to his offerings on his first date.
And we wanted to say very excited. And we wanted to show you all the family photo, the father, Thomas, the mother, Higley, his sister, Aretha, and the son, of course, by the name of his worthy handsome Ohan. Ohan Higley, this is the family's name to Armenian. And Ohan actually means Jean in Armenian. So this is actually the real name. In fact, it's interesting to point out, his actual maker's mark was actually an O and a T with a column of the plus one for his entire career. see the square line with all his numbers transformed because we're really later. But you see the little Ohan, who's 7. He's now 7 years older. And the family, he's born in New York, he and his sister. His mother is working in the textiles industry, his father's a mechanic, and also quite successful. But when the war breaks out in 1939, they decide to go to a suburb of Paris called Gay-Eckel, West Bend. Why? Because they like to be closer to the in-laws, to the family of his wife, who were quite prominent, weren't they? They were photographers, and they lived to the
place. And the family had been the primary, most famous photographer in the island.
So, yes, so this family, they joined and they lived in this area, right outside Paris. And our poor Ohan, when he's around 11 years old, at school, they discover that he has this kind of a condition in his lungs. They think it might be pneumonia. So they sent him off to the country, the countryside northeast of Paris, and the end.
So that was 1941. He's 11 years old.
Yes, he's 11 years old.
And this is why we say he came in and encounters, because how did he get this education? What happened to the fall?
Well, the original thing is the one who's...
He gets his education because he leaves school and he gets a different kind of education.
Oh, yes, yes. Well, first of all, he's in the countryside.
Mm-hmm.
And then after, when he comes back to Paris when he's 13. And his mother decides he just doesn't want to go to school. He wants to do something with his conscience because he keeps in trouble. And he wants to actually do something. And he's put into a sort of apprenticeship with his uncle. His uncle, who is a prominent jeweler in Paris, in the 1900s, not Paris, named Gay. But before that,
yeah, he needs him to go
to college.
Because before that, there was this incredible moment that happened when he was 11 in that town, which I thought meant old farm, name and dog. It's a farm, it's a town, it's very old. I remember when he was old, I thought they put him on an old farm, which would make sense, but it's a town, way, way off in France. And what happened on this long in the field?
Well, when he was still in his convalescent period, there was a French fighter jet that had crashed. I forget, it was World War II, but it was also his period. And he took a piece of the fuselage, the actual sheet metal, and he created this beautiful work. Just using the basic tools, I think he had a screwdriver and some other kind of tools. And he showed his gift at some young age. He created this piece, which is extremely moving. If you look carefully at this pattern, he called it Christ. And you see the face of Christ with the thorns. It's an extremely moving piece. It's almost conceptual art, isn't it, with these flowers?
Well, to me, it's both, because as you know, conceptual art, I'm not a big answer to that, but to me, what really gets me is if you look at just the metal first, so the metal that's in the foreground, and you don't really see Christ, but as you say, it qualifies as the second art, which during the time period he's about to grow up into, is almost, if you don't do conceptual art, you're almost a rebel, almost a bad person. And but you go through, and there's the shadow is the patient, and this is a point, the Christian religious experience.
Yes, yes. The faith of his parents is one of the things that got them through because they went through a lot of when they changed countries, etc. And he always talked about, we heard Steve tell us, we'll talk about this in the course of the interview, but his son, he said that his parents were very pious and they were always doing good work and very strong faith. And so at his very young age, Ohan, who was put back, and he created this beautiful piece showing his dexterity. He hadn't had much to do yet.
And that's the point when he apparently knew that he wanted to do this as a profession. That he knew that he wanted to become that person who was doing as a profession.
Exactly. He was someone who was good with his parents. He enjoyed that role, but he also had a vision. His mother decided to send him into an apprenticeship when he came out of Paris with his uncle, Derek, who was a very well-known jeweler at the time in the Art of Jean Vendome in Paris. And he learned all of the basics, more than the basics. His uncle had won an award for in France, they say, the best sort of offspring of the year. And he taught Ohan all of the techniques of doing jewelry. And he was very technically skilled and also artistically, because at night, Ohan, who was allowed to take courses at night after a full day's work, he would go to courses in drawing and even sculpture at Beaux-Arts in Paris. And probably the drawing school, they had evening drawing schools in Paris to teach young people that wanted to have a career in their fine arts. And so Ohan became very technically skilled and also at drafting. And when he was 15, his teacher secretly gave a drawing to a contest in Paris. And he for the evening, and also as a jeweler, but he wins a prize. As this really launches his career, he knows that he wants to be a jeweler, and so much so that he starts at the age of 16. He starts studying with and George Google. They're two great gemologists who are teaching at the National Institute of Gemology in Paris. Now, imagine a young man who hasn't been to school, he hasn't done math, he hasn't done chemistry, and he's learning gemology, which is extremely technical. And he struggled through, and I think Dino Lewis saw his love of film. He was actually a precursor to using different colored films, which he would do in a much grander scale. So he learned this love of crystals and of films and the crystals from Dino Lewis.
He had an indelible influence and he had it because they find each other, as we'll find out later on in our story, they find each other again. We all saw how for now. But he influenced his life. So what happens to our Oman? So our Oman is working with his uncle, and as he becomes an older young man at 18, they hire some kind of type, and he decides he wants to join his uncle. So the problem is, in fact, in those days, he had to be 21 to be considered to be a certain person. And in fact, so he goes to the police, and he asks to be liberated. Emancipated,
does the court procedure.
He does the court procedure, and he wins the procedure, and he ends up with his first moderate trial.
Actually, as Jerry was telling me, we asked him, he addressed again this afternoon, which we're going to remember, I've forgotten, but he said that it was the largest window space door available anywhere. So he ends up with this giant window space at the end of 18 without a dollar in his pocket.
Absolutely.
And he asked Terry, how did you do that? And it's at the foot of Montmartre.
And he's like, Montmartre, so he's good for you.
Thank you. The foot of Montmartre, like a foot, like a pen, yes. And wasn't it doing how long did he get this bill? He had no one. He's 18 years old. Paul and I were saying, we wish we had that book together when we were 18. He goes to this friend of mine, who is a Holocaust survivor, 1948, he's 18. And he says, I see you have that big shop there with all that window space. It's empty. To do business like Paris. And you think the law says, no? He says in the French version of what I would call chutzpah, kid, you got chutzpah. And in French, basically. And he says, okay, take the store, and I'll use you to repair for the place, for my business. You can do your repairs for me. And what Terry tells us is,
he took a colleague who was a watch repairman and maker, and his friend who worked in his with him. And it's extremely important because later, 2 years later, he knows the watch peak address, which is a blue light detail in Paris. He has his first real spot. And he actually puts
at the right old age of 20.
At 20, thank you. He puts on the sign that he's actually a watchmaker, and a jeweler. So this early learning of skills of watchmaking would actually be a pivot for him to meet very many interesting people.
Well, there's serendipity is really the rule in life. It's this whole story. I think, don't you agree? How serendipity, because now he's 23, well into middle age, and he realizes he needs to do his military service. So he pops off to his military service, and another serendipity is going to be able to do it.
Yes, the story is an unusual story. He is doing his military service, and he's 23 years old. And for some reason, he's not in the barracks with all the rest. He's in the officers' quarters, which are in town. But these officers' quarters are not what he's been at. They were, his apartment was still occupied. It did have windows onto the street, and he tells stories of he covered the walls, but the paint was flaking off the walls. So he covered the walls with his own drawings, and as we all know, he was just really fascinated by them. He had already been working as a jeweler since like 13 or 10 years ago. And somebody
was a nice day, luckily the windows were open, right?
Yes, and somebody walks by.
That's what happens to be the head of the clothesline for the
drawings. He sees the drawings, and he's so taken by the drawings, he finds out that they were going on the wrong ground. And he asked Oman to introduce him to the general. So he goes to the general on another occasion. And Oman is so nervous he's studying for century in the Holy Age. And the director of the school, the art school, says, do you really need this young man? He's useless to you. And the general is so surprised that he said, he's a very talented artist, and would you allow him to study art with me while he's doing his military service? And as Jimmy told us, it was the first time that this was ever
colleague that we know that was allowed to come through. So again, here we go, serendipity, luck.
And this is
here,
this is
the only
This is the only one. So he stays away, he comes back to Paris, he goes back into business, he goes to a family dinner with friends, and he happens to love Joel's classical music, and a beautiful young, charming, witty, intelligent young lady hands him a Joel's classical record, and love is in the air, they fall in love, they get married, and in 1930, Joel comes along.
Yes. So, this is with, yes, with yes, probably meeting with
the
this love affair lasted until the interesting, we wanted to show you this early piece. It's called Malpaque, which in French roughly translates to badly paid. And what he did was, he was a great admirer of the great Art Nouveau master jeweler, who would use enamels and glass for those of the jewelry that was out there. I don't think I need to tell you too much about what he did. He created works of art. And he loved color so much, but he didn't have much money. So what he did was, in those days, there were certain stones that were sold by bulk to put in his system. And he had these beautiful colored stones, which happened to be cornerings and diamonds, stones today, which have quite a much more expensive. And he took them like gold, and he made this piece as a love offering for Nelly. And for him, it was also a way of showing that he didn't, you can always see he's leading, he doesn't care about chemistry. Look at the way he sets those things.
Because what he says is godfather and all, it was really relief.
Exactly. So asymmetry is color. And it's actually has a, just like Galicia, it has a very romantic story.
Which is, isn't it?
The Pavé in France is actually the cobblestones in his kids. And it was reminiscent of the walks that he and Elliot took to the house on a rainy day. And this beautiful, this is actually Inezita's photo, so you can have a feel for what the pavé, what these irregular pavé actually look like.
I told it to Terry, I just said, can I just show you this kind of style? And he said, that's it, exactly. That's them walking by the side of the reversal and thinking, oh, I'll just draw back gently to the background, walking along in the vegetarian house and thinking of his old past life before. And it's great, come on. Excuse me,
that's okay. Today is about, we're going back and forth in time as well, because he was such a universal figure, he wasn't able to have a cultural mandate.
So it's the 1957 of a coming forward when he's really blooming.
Right, he's experimenting all the time, and he had new jewelry, if you will, traditional jewelry for high jewelry baskets. And he didn't want to do the same thing. He liked his symmetry, he liked color and stones. And one day, again, another meeting, and that's why the titles of this chapter, he meets a local to this French woman
that he's still,
he comes in the store. This John Curtis, and his uncle Phil walks in with a gold nugget, and he says, could you please, Mr. Owen, make me something with this nugget, and they discuss a pendant, and then the idea for cufflinks comes up. Well, there's only one nugget. So what does he do? He starts working on creating a nugget himself. So what he does is he works the gold in new ways, he fires the gold, and when the gold is on a molten plate, he hammers it, and he uses water, and he gets all these different effects. And the word for a golden nugget in French is petit. So this is why he called it the petit. And the actual cufflinks were a great success, and he created a whole collection called petit. Excuse me. And so this idea of, if you look at, let's go back into the early 50s, when we look at this now, it's like, yes, we've seen this, but imagine somebody doing this gold, it looks like native gold, if you see the native gold when it's pulled out of here, and he did it on purpose, and it's done with his own hands. Another important thing is that Ohan, Zerig, never used molding, he never used glass techniques, everything was from hand. So he works the gold in many different ways. He gets that standard effect, he gets that matte effect. And you can see that he can adapt it to so many different pieces. On the slide, you see a necklace on the left with diamonds. And he does use diamonds, but as little accents, just like the lady. And on the right, he even uses rubies and sorry, with coarser pearls. So this is one of his major discoveries and one of his first major collections. It had a huge impact on the world of jewelry, and some of you might be recognizing this fresh gold. You see others doing it as well. It becomes sort of, in a different way, the trademark of people like Chanel with the dripping, and Albert Grimaud, and Andrew Grimaud. So you see he was a precursor and became an art steward from early on.
But what a lot of people do is they then ride a thing like that to the end of their career. Not on them. And this is going to be coming out, and I'll tell you how that happens. But not on them. We take something else, makes it spectacular, and then say, okay, now I'm going to go create something else. I'm going to go away. And we have here this innovation, which again changed jewelry history, and this innovation took two away. Perhaps if we look at the design, we start to get a sense of the hand, what we call the hand of Jean Vendome, which we have a design course coming up at the school soon that we've been working on, called the Art of Jean Vendome, and working on for years, it's going to be born soon at Inezita. And in that design course, about jewelry design, we look at design as the art form that it truly is and deserves to be respected as. I think how it's both very precise, but also very impressionistic, very momentary in his way of thinking. And now, let's look maybe at some of the rings and see what he did with these two rings.
So, the ring, the two rings followed, what we call it now. And the idea of having an open ring, first of all, is revolutionary. So, it basically looks like the hand is where the stones are sort of floating in between the two fingers. And it's actually, it looks like it's sort of like a square, but it's very comfortable to wear. And Vendome, or Oman at the time, he had an idea about his hands, about the hands are part of language, about what I did and moving my hands a lot. He thought that the hands were an extension of verbal communication, and he thought it was better to have a ring that was open because you're not cutting off the communication, you're not cutting the finger in two. And it became iconic and one of his most popular pieces, as you can see, starting in 1956, all the way to the ones on the far right, which is from the 2000s, probably in 2006. And you'll also notice, though, he takes the stones. He uses stones, they're protruding, you have sea chains, you have emeralds, you have beautiful tourmaline and Christmas fish, and watermelon tourmaline, and even once in a while diamonds, but the idea that these stones are basically growing out of somebody's hands, people love it, and actually to the end of his career, he was making these color rings.
I do love that.
It's beautiful.
And it's the living ring of the stone, it's the color ring of the stone, which what did you say earlier, not putting it into a hole?
Exactly, it's not that's what we'll see that later with the essence. It's sort of honoring the crystals and putting them out there to the people to see.
But, once again, we move on. Because that's a story, and he does continue to explore that. The Chinese rearing is more than 30,000 pieces. But somewhere around, according to Sherry Vendome, 80% of those pieces are one of kind, unique. And he creates, he moves on to another collection, another idea, or longing, he calls it. It's not a collection in the sense of this is the collection we're marketing, it's a longing, it's a follow-up,
right after. Now this piece is very long. So the reason it's actually the process by which he made this piece. We can read it in this book that we're going to talk a lot about today about Marlene Coldenberg, she wrote a fantastic book where she interviewed Jean Vendome, she has a privilege. And he talks about the idea of having a flash. He had a flash, he saw perhaps the pattern of the sidewalk is the side on the right, and he saw some kind of liquid that was spewing out with little scintillating light. And he went right to the workshop and started sketching it because this idea of this flash, this intuition. And Vendome strongly believed that the shorter period between the actual idea and the reality is going to be the better. So he went to his studio and he created this boreal. Now, the boreal, of course, it makes us think of the arrival of Alice, and there's a reason. He became friends through his watchmaking skills with a great explorer. He would come and have his boxes prepared, and he would tell about these explorations in the north, in the North Pole, etc. So So the actual name of the collection, notice how now he's become quite spiky and very funny. We have a very baroque idea of the picture. And the modern, very sculptural But if you also, there's a story behind this, which is very moving. If you look carefully at the piece from far away, there's an idea that this is after the war. It was a very traumatic period. They were traumatized, and people were trying to get over this idea. And the idea was there was a sound that if only human heart could just hold hands, and people would be okay. And this is one of the inspirations for the album as well. If you look carefully, it looks like little figures that make things all together. So all of these inspirations, he was so brilliant the way he did, and he blended all those ideas.
And then the ink splotches, and the ink splotches on the sidewalk, are Jerry Vendome's pictures. So he's sort of following the inspiration of his father, the way I like to photograph colorstones. He likes to photograph these sculptures. So this is actually Jerry Vendome's picture of the sculpture, which looks so much like his father's work. And once again, though, he was created and he played with that, and he'll make a certain number of pieces, he may stop and never do it again. And then he moves on to whatever one being done, palace by night. He cannot create anywhere but in palace. That's his seed for creation. So he looks at palace by night. For example, we just pulled a beautiful picture that is very much like what he talks about, the movement of the lights, the way that the series, the length of the cars, the traffic, the bridges, the water. And he says, he calls it nocturne, and he was inspired by, I'm sure, it's interesting what his photography plays into this. There was a photograph of the classical Delphi photograph in Paris, with the cars and the rainwater and the way that the light was passed off of the rain. And you can see that when you look at this main piece, the brooch, this elongated gold, and with little stars, and he's actually sliding it or making it look sort of matte. And he's just using the diamonds that, just again, just with little accents, and these aquamarines, which is one of his other famous things. This is why I love this one. It's incredible the way it's 26 different Bjorka shows. Bjorka is such an esteemed show. 26. And we're looking at one picture of one particular year when something very historical happens, right, Paul?
Yes. Would you like to tell them?
Well, what happens is, first of all, he's a success, and I think it's really fun to look at the picture of how he did his stand-up, because he's so genuine looking into the world, but there are also the crystals, the natural crystals, and he has a pink sitting in the background of a friend, but he has the Vendome name, stamp number 363.
Yes, so here we are with the moment. It was the end of the 50s. He had a sanity. He's the name Vendome. If you notice, there's no talk of the year. It was intentional. And it's a little bit of a conscious piece by looking back when he used to make films for some of the maisons on the Place Vendome. This was according to his friends. And a lady comes up very angry and says, "We cannot use this name. This is my name. I've registered it as a trademark." And she's furious. And he is so afraid, he calls one of his friends, who happens to be a lawyer, and his friend tells him, he actually was accompanied by a bailiff, one of his good friends, so he was very intimidated. He called a lawyer from him, and the friend gave him that man, just put a J or a letter in front of the Vendome, and then it's not a trademark. And that's what he did, he put J. It says, well, for a long time, to talk to him. So this is why he became a child of Vendome.
And I love focusing on him because of his charisma and his charm and his
personality.
And we thought we would carry the talk with about his friendship with this painter and other painters. But he worked in a, not in a medical field environment, but a very synthesizing environment of influence and part of a man of his time, Léon Dutton. And he was a very good friend with this particular artist.
Yes, he was friends with the Humanity Father Brenner, who was from the Catalan school, but it was a moment in Europe where they were experimenting with abstract expressionism, with different materials. You can see this is obviously a painting that has other mixed media. And this particular painter was very interested in a single language and paint representing a universal language. So, you know, this was a very rich period in the arts.
It's got nails
Yeah. And the thing about Jean Vendome is that he wasn't as much inspired by other jewelry as he was inspired by the art, photography, by painting, sculpture, he studied sculpture. And so, and also by students, and friends, and meetings. So it's a very beautiful way. It inspired all of his creations, where it's part of my life at some point.
And so here with this collection, he thought, as you were saying, we were discussing earlier today, that diamonds weren't being treated properly, they weren't being used properly.
Yes, but going back in French, I believe it means when you select this. And he recognized this also, his idea, he said in the 60s, nothing was happening, it was a strange period. I didn't want to do any more sports modules. I was looking for the idea. I had the idea of just finding sort of scattering down the forward and positively on somebody rather than having them all tied in a very tight. So this idea is that of the diamonds that I was showing as these jewels, where the diamonds, he said the diamonds are not strong or spooky. He thought diamonds were being mistreated. And the way that when a lady wears it, it doesn't look like the diamonds are powered down on them.
And it can very romantic, but it also then can go into quite an abstract patterning, and you see how it's a sort of surround in that crystal. The crystal, this is a person who, there's some of our students were asking at last night, which is in terms of those things. He actually did have his own stones, it became a passion. And that's a passion that has caught the rhythm from Dylan Gravel and
his own.
And he was seeing it at the Tucson shows, at the San Marino shows, when we had no more shows, which I hope we have again. And here he's taking that new flow and he's putting it on the neck of the crystal. But he also will remain a good thing. He's an artist who works with the metal, who thinks about other artists, even to the point of learning from artists like.
Well, probably the idea, of course, is the realist, who was quite famous by this time in the early 60s, 1962. And the two men had met on other occasions, personalities and whatnot. And Dali asked him if he would create a jewel for him with the designs that he produced. And Salvador was, don't forget he's been in this business already, he's like, he understood that he's been. And he said, of course, I'll do this for you next year, but you have to agree that the jewel will be my creation for you, that you'll give me credit. And he said, yes. So he creates this, from Dali's drawings, this butterfly, which you can see is quite beautiful. It's like feathers and like gold, etc. And then he's glorified one day Dali is doing a TV interview, and he shows the butterfly and says, this is my new technique. I throw molten gold into water, and I pull out, and it miraculously looks like this butterfly.
Oh, every time I throw gold into
water. So he was furious when John saw this, and he ran to the hotel that he was staying in the hotel. And the story that is true, he threw the drawings back at Dali to see it, and now, of course, not a good idea.
Well, there are three sad things. One is if they were kept in their own city, they worth a lot of money. And the other thing is, where is the butterfly?
It's gone.
We don't know where it is. So it was made at one time. He looked at all the dirt. He made the money. He's never going to make that again. That's for sure. It was very emotional. And there's that butterfly out on the front of the road somewhere. And we're hoping that movie's talks, maybe somebody's going to tell us where that butterfly is. That's how it happens. If you talk about something, you're going to try it. If you know where the butterfly is, you're going to let us know.
Or experience
is this. This is the creativity, the prevalence, as I know, as the word is gracious, I'm using for studying my readers, but the spectrum of amazing creativity is so that this is now the conjurer, the hour room, the guest room, the tour power room, the different jewels, catches the attention of the lady who writes the articles for the Rouge Encyclopedia.
Yes, exactly. So this is a period of Jean Vendome creates these open rings, and he loves the idea of having the sky expand, the sky with the light shining through it, and the S-ring, which we'll see in the next couple more detail. But these open rings were a huge success, and they were really expressing this idea of modernism and putting the stone to the forefront. And he had participated in what is called the Grand Architecture Forum, which is an old-fashioned sort of French institution from the early 1901 and 1904. And this lady had seen his work, this lady who was doing the illustrated encyclopedia, and she put him in the was with the cat frame, which you can see on the right of the
fun for the family. We'll take you to the next slide so you can see from the exhibition, and you can also climb into these, in this pool of oxygen, basically the days and hop in these pools in there, and see what Paul's going to tell you about the liberating of the stone and letting the stone
When he was thinking of the escalator, he said, this is actually a job that the cell is not set in a hole. You can actually see the color at the bottom of the cell, which is above the person's finger. And he talks about light and the transparency and all of the things that he had developed in college. He taught him to look at cells and evaluate them just for beliefs. So he loved this idea of openness, and I talked earlier about body mind brains. Open mind is the idea that brain is an extension of both the hand and all the space and communication. So this S-plane, just like the tool, becomes very iconic in his collections. And here's a beautiful version of two different stones, a double one. So he's not afraid of anything.
No. All of this and
of course.
And you can see the shadow, even the stone is so free that it's reflecting onto the gold. It's just this going and on creativity, almost even to the point of being able to capture the spirit of a place he's never even been to. At that point, he'd never been to Savannah, to New York. And look what he did.
Yeah, so this is another sort of jump into a different world. It's just these spikes are actually representing skyscrapers. And yes, when he made the first Savannah Ring in 1966, he was not there in New York yet. But it was so impressive, it was a shock when he was looking at the images on the TV, on the photos. So he created, again, this very sculptural with these skyscrapers, all different heights, and the complexity of setting the stones in these different heights, all of the openings and the bezels of different lengths. And it became sort of a symbol of his love for the United States, and he did eventually go. And he also created the Manhattan Ring, which is you had told me that, of course, when you see the green, all over the left, it's actually, of course, Central Park, and there's new
things. All over the front here,
yes, he told us.
So the emerald is the pool of green, which is New York. How many of you are finally left New York to come and live in Paris because of the school? I came here for the school. And indeed, that pool of greenness in the center of those canyons is something you yearn for. He caught all this in his summary. He made only about 50 and 42 diamonds, like the heart of New York, 42nd Street. Only about 50 we have some here in the exhibition. You can use the pictures from Vendome and Shelley online. And you actually can see. You can see how he captures the spirit of those colonies and those golden buildings.
It's actually one of the things that he spoke about and was good at was finding a balance between sculpture and something available. As we progress, we'll notice his tools are always innovative in the way they wanted the body. He wasn't just interested in putting something on the aspects, but he wanted it to really be used with the person's perspective.
And unfortunately, you aren't able to try them on. But when someone wears them in front of you or you test them on to try on, you find out that as improbable as something is trying to see when you look at this as a work of art, I promise. Right, Paul?
It's all very comfortable. You told me that.
I had a chance to try some art. Now, here we go. The full box is said, hey, this is incredibly impractical. So we showed you three pictures of real women on the right, if you got it.
Yes.
Mom and Jerry, the one on the left, one of his great news, and and on the left is the secretary of Montague.
Yeah. He was actually starting as a model. Now, think of it, this is sort of, the groovy period, the 60s. Jewelry's becoming less codified, as we can see. He creates an actual product as a necktie for women in sort of jewelry. And it's actually, he loves to use the tourmalines in the middle, especially. His great level one is especially these sliced tourmalines. And there's a beautiful way that he described this. He said the light, the transparency of the stone allows the light to interact with the skin, and the skin interacts with the stone, and then it causes the whole space, the whole part of the woman's body to glow. So, yes, that must be more than that. Oh, it was reversible. That's great to do that. But he was, technically, he was extremely skilled at doing all of these ultra-familiar tools. You can see the technical skill involved and also the artistry of the pieces.
Exactly. Soft and flowy.
Yes.
Perfect.
I think there's even some business where the stones could be interchanged, if I read correctly. But extremely modern, extremely well executed, and all about color and stones.
Speaking of modern and modern, speaking of that era, what was the thing at that time? It was 1969.
people like you know,
yes.
Like Paul,
of course, Paul is the rest
of the school, but of course, the Omaha's Paul, and it was all sort of Paul 11 in 1969. And of course, it becomes a theme in Germany. And Vendome did not use green at the cosmos, and you can see this in the collection. They weren't really collections, they were inspired. On the left, we have a beautiful panel of sort of the moon and the earth. And he uses a crater style. Remember how the left pole of gold also represents the moon's surface. And the actual space is brushed white gold. And the earth is that little ball of opal and white. And he also likes to say that those stones represented the Milky Way. So very poetically of looking at space, and yes, it became a very popular theme in Jordan.
So everything that happens in his life, everything that happens around him, everything of his era, the art movement, even cars, is a possible source of inspiration.
So you think, yes, well, what we're showing you here, the 60s was a great period when he became very, very well known. He had participated in all of these salons, he had participated in this very famous metamorphosis that he just did with Brock and he had won the prize of the National Merit of Honor, which is the second highest prize you can get in France after Olympia Water. He was very, very, very well known. And this is, he's vindicated because in this year, 1969, I believe, is 60, this is the 69, my best is he actually moved to the Regis Goldberg Center, which, as you all know, is a very secret very, very, very close to the
Capitol. It's perfect 60s environment here, the leopard coat, the guy with the sideburns, the dog, it's all there, yes. It's all there, and then in the window, if you look on the right, in the window are these very moving, mob showpieces with the cravat and all the other pieces that are in.
This is a very conservative, a little bit conservative part of town. For him, in those days, he was selling this in the late 60s. He had really come full circle, and people were really people came from this. And of course, this is a period of great creativity as well.
So around that time, the real thing that turned out to be maybe in terms of two lives in a way is the moving money.
Oh, yes, of course. So, Jose Calvo is a very famous writer and a French writer and philosopher who was in love with stones. And he actually heard about Calvo and approved him in the vault. And so now he was actually the curator of the Natural History Museum of Paris. And they told him he was actually elected to the French Academy. Now, the French Academy, of course, is based back in the 1630s. It's before the immortals were supposed to keep French culture and French language intact. And it's a lifetime membership, so it's very rare that a seat is free. So this man of letters, he was actually given a seat. So the tradition is he had a sword made, and because when you're inducted, you wear the seat of justice. And so he goes, unbeknownst to Jean Vendome, he goes to talk with his wife on the map. And he pretends to be interested, he was interested in the 5,000 agreement. He brought him to his wife on the map. And he tracks him up, and Vendome realizes right away this man knows a lot about stones. It was his passion. And in fact, right, he's studying his great book about the writing of stones and the objects and all of them.
All the green stones, all these things. A lot of what is inspiring the collection we see here is in the Museum of Natural History, which he left stones to them, which are green patterns and green stones.
And that's the one we're going to see in this kind of period. So, my work is we're going to make my academic thesis for. And Vendome was very flattered that this man, who is an erudite and written so many books, and he leaves him with some of his books that he calls them symbols that he wants. And what they do is they go to dinner a couple of weeks later when Vendome is at home with his sketches, and they're talking and having dinner, and Vendome has the sketches under the table for the tea. And of course, Roger Calvo's taking more and more attention as dessert comes, he says, please can I see one of your designs? And Vendome pulls out just one from the tea. And he shows it to him, and Calvo is so taken by that. He says, that's the one I don't even want to see the others.
And if you want to see that drawing, which is stupendous, we didn't put it in here because it's in the website. It's in that virtual exhibition online that's been so carefully prepared for you. So we want you to go ahead and check it in and find it. Dr. Vaughn, the first best way was to cut it off, and he said, that's my sword. Now, we do have the sword here. We have loads of gorgeous pictures here that explore his logo, and we'll tell you about what that sword means.
So, one of the things that Tomoko does love about Julian's swords is that he wants to pack all of the symbols of a man's life into a scabbard, into the handle, into the guard. And you can see here, he incorporates many symbols. This beautiful twirling in the handle of the sword, which is a very moving story, which we'll tell in a little bit. The top, the pommel, is actually a piece of moldavite from space, with diamonds representing his public cross, because how well he was the head of the publication, a series of publications called the Southern Cross. You have also this beautiful, they love Brazil, by the way, Taiwan loved Brazil, which is why he chose this tournament. And you have this beautiful quartz with dendrites, arboricum dendrites that look like trees. And for Kaiwa and for Tomoko, they represent perfection. And if you look at these garnets are from Bohemia, because I imagine it's from originally from Czechoslovakia. And it's actually the shape of an octopus. Why? Because Kaiwa believed that octopuses were the most intelligent of living things. So you see those symbols that you talk about for art, and you'll see the style is very significant. If you look at the way the gold spikes out. And also one of the sort of thoughts of this piece is that although he emptied out the swords of blade and he inserted these obliquely cut, beautiful colored corridors and amethysts in there, so it's like a stained glass window, and he added these little springs which protects them so that when it's moved, they don't break. So again, this one sword is jam-packed with symbols.
And it changes the way people perceive him. It changes their lives because they become great friends.
And when they go on vacation together, they become great friends. They spend holidays together in their house, and they have a house in the home, the port of the place, and the English channel, etc.
And it's not going to come to life.
Well,
and we're going to have a heart attack.
Yeah, so the story is, Rizal Paiwan was actually in a small market in Paris, and he fell over in 1998 and had a heart attack. And he was actually on the ground, and they took him away, and I believe they tried to revive him. And in his hand, he was holding this agate, which you can see on the line there when the exhibition opens.
It's here.
It's actually quite big. It's just big. And he was holding it in his hands, and Jean Vendome, after his death, that he had willed it, he wanted him to hide it. And he understood when he saw it, because it's actually, Taiwan's last work was the Alpheus River. The Alpheus River is this river in ancient Greece, a river that becomes in love with that sort of myth. The river flows into the sea and disappears and searches and searches, and he ends up in Italy as another river. So this idea of the source, you can see at the top, originally when he's a river, he flows down into the sea, and on the bottom left, he becomes a river. It's really symbolic way of saying that everyone goes through trials and tribulations and comes back to the source. So it's very moving that he had left his friend, and Jean Vendome understood the message after when he thought about it. And he looked at this
study. It's fascinating to me that he never did anything with the study, just kept it, which is also the nature. And on the right is on the right hand side is something that the Kaiwa has written into Jean Vendome's leave a dog, memory book that you even stole. And just lets you know some of the words that will translate the whole thing, but amici and complicity in the taste of stones. Rachel Kaiwa also wrote about Jean Vendome, that this is a person who, unlike most people see him because of my intellect, and he's this enormous, giant intellect. This person, whether or not he even read my books, this person cares for me as a human, as a person, as a man. And this is a very touching story, and there's this constant human aspect, there's this constant emotion in the holistic artist. It's his world, it's everything he sees that influences him. It's his friends, it's looking at how jewels look when they're worn on different ladies. And of course, Nelly, this couple ring was really inspired by his relationship with Nelly. And we'll read you a lovely little passage that Jean Vendome wrote about Nelly that Paul translated for us. I think that without Nelly, I would never have taken off. She was smarter than me. She was smart, the man standing on his question. She was smarter than me, and I constantly tried to correct this imbalance. This irreducible difference was my taste. In truth, I still think I challenge myself to keep her close to me by dazzling her with what I put my hands on my shoulders. Words were her uniform. My presentation was the workshop. I disagree, he was a poet. The couple was born that way, the couple ring. It was not a ring instead of jewels, but rather the desire to send her a message with these two sounds that face each other, that oppose and unite by two differences. This ring is very beautiful because it reminds us of our beginnings, our life, and inevitably of our exits. And now he dies at age 50 from cancer. So he declared his dad's very vulnerabilities, entrusting us with this quote, which is also memorialized in his book by Honor to the Midway. And with that background, you don't need to know that, and that's what's really important about jewelry as a work of art. You never should need to know a story to appreciate the beauty. You could just love it. You just look at it and love the way the crystals, the are completely free and beautiful. But you could also love the story and all the way around it.
That's what you love about the topaz and the opposing force for this painting. Completely colorless topaz and the underlying of the
topaz. Another way to explore the value of the creature is its lead to something that's very important to the family. You can't read this page, but this stops for just a second to say, not only in the Lotus Encyclopedia, but in the Lotus Dictionary. And here he's Vendome, so Vendome J, right after Vendée, the place of France, and J the Lotus Z, which is a type of disease that you can imagine. And those are moving to the family. But what it is the history to the family of getting into both those books with an emphasis that came with just two suitcases, a suitcase each. From this horrible refugee situation. And they built all this beauty.
I think that's why Vendome was the first jeweler to have his proper name in both these books in his lifetime.
Yes, that is right. Yes, absolutely. Now we move on to, again, here's a jewel of one and a jewel by itself as a teenager, the Barracudas. It's in the Kimberly Costerman collection. And the Kimberly Costerman collection should right now be under an exhibition in London. Right now, we've gone to the virtual world, and we're so grateful to the call to bring us into your homes. Hopefully, our exhibition will open again, and we'll know about it. But we wanted to show you this work with crystals and how it is flowing and comfortable when it's on. The crystal is left free, but it's flowing and comfortable. And next to that, the idea of our next slide, the piece that is made with the slices of stones in a very special way, right?
Yes, he loved the sliced stones and he loved it for us to see all the different colors. In fact, this piece on the left is extremely technical. Actually, it's fun to put this. These actual joints related to stones, depth, and relief, they're based on universal joints from automobiles and crash boxes, etc. So, again, the artist can join us with technique. All done by hand, and again, he's putting forth more and more. He goes through phases where crystals become much more prominent, these big crystals that we just saw, and then he'll become like those, and he goes back to the crystals as his life progresses. So, this piece is really moving to see all these colorings and amethysts and different colors that are just harvested from the dark
and amethysts. And we know what Paul just said about the joints of automobiles, but those joints are covered up by strange high jewelry set, specially cut diamonds. So never think that he left aside the ivory techniques. They are used in a multiplicity of ways to create the sort of modern jewelry art of the crystal today, which is a very, in a way, incredibly modern, embodies his life, what he loves, and is an homage in his way to his artistic godfather, the Mona Lisa, right?
Yes, it's actually a story. There's a story. It's actually a little bit of this piece.
Yeah.
It's actually a sailboat, the reflection of a sailboat in reverse. So you see with this rudimentary quartz on the lower part, which is actually would be the actual boat, and the sea is in the middle, and then the reflection of the diamonds, which is on the top. So it's life in reverse, but also a way of showing a tiny story.
And he uses the rudimentary quartz, which in your last talk with people, you talked about angel hair and Venus hair, the same quartz for the mutilation of Venus. Now, he uses it to make you think of the sun going on planets. It is a stone that inspires poetry. And one thing for sure about Mona Lisa is in his world, he found poetry. But what were his words? After that great success with the Roger Carlos Solomon, there is an incredible success with Unicorn Stories.
Well, yes, Julian Green was one of the first American, he was an archaeological writer, a great writer, autobiography stories. He was extremely religious, and he got to speak in the to help them collect more of the right with these stretched out gold and white gold. And so in this story, he ends up talking in around five symbols. And since Julian Reed was a very religious man, he starts on the top. There's actually a really big crystal on the top, and the hand of God comes down, touching the latter drink of flower, and you have some obsidian as the handle. And that actual sword guard, the hand guard around it, is 150 pieces of lapis lazuli with diamonds to represent stars. And at the bottom, you don't actually have another religious symbol. You have grapes with these emeralds and rubies, and you have a wheat sheet. And there's actually even an inscription, I think it's So you see this, he puts all of these symbols into one piece, and that's one of the things we like about the religious stories.
So we can go, we can't look at all of them, but quickly, this one really touched us for a second, because, first of all, he asked the drapery of Cinco Retro to be embodied in the piece, right? And who was this person? He was
Maurice Dumont was a very important figure during the war, and he was the voice of free France for the Gaulle at the time. And he became very involved later in the government. He was a minister for the Gaulle and for Fouquet. So he was a man of letters as well, and of course, he became one of the heroes of the story as well. But this story actually,
if you're going to check, you need to be out
there. Well, he actually says that this was the masterpiece of the story. Because the way that the gold on the handle, it's like poisonous, because it's representing the war and also the landing of the Allies in Normandy, because it's the tower of the ship. And the way that gold, the handle and the gold, it reminds us of that drapery of Cinco Retro, because Simon loves Cinco Retro. There's even a little flower hidden somewhere which represents where he has been a senator. You have scissors cutting. We can't see it all, so importantly, at the bottom of the guard, you have actually this cross of nails, which is, of course, representing the text of Jesus, Christ. And you have a crown of thorns, which also represents the Constitution text, because Simon, of course, was quite involved in the war. So again, with this inspiration from the Renaissance, he creates this great gold, which is extremely amazing.
Now, that's just three out of the number. We don't have time to go through all of that, but that gives you an idea of how complex. We wanted to take a moment to dwell on this tree. It was made from the Museum of Natural History's collection. Francois Fars and Thierry Vendome together put the trees back together for the Museum of Natural History's collection exhibition, which we hope will go on until June, and we hope will open up again. But we wanted to share that with you so you could experience again how a work of art, an object like this, can be done using not only slices of tourmalines, but also jewels from the crown jewels of France. We could go on and on all night, but we don't have all that much time. We wanted to look also at the fact that he was so international, and different cultures. He was the first really modern jeweler to be invited. He met the emperor in Japan. As you can see here, the Mitsumoto was very, very interested in his work. Here you can see different spirits, again, of the Japanese aesthetic spirit.
He adopted his work for Mitsumoto for such kind of girls. He had already, as he said, he was invited to the God, the Emperor's father, invited him to meet her, etc. He was basically like a release card, as you can see on that magazine on the left.
And that, of course, opened a chapter, the Sharon Cole chapter, which is this burgeoning creativity. That burgeoning creativity is also part of teaching. So we wanted to show you this genre known as Bench, surrounded by the young people, because for several years he taught, and he almost was too creative in his teaching, and he almost sort of liberated the students a little bit too much in a way, but he shared his talk. That was very much a part of what he was doing. And we thought it was great to have this picture of him at his workbench next, maybe the piece that the piece is very exhibition, which you can see in very high depth if you want to go further looking at the pieces.
Yes, this diagonal necklace with, again, this Venus hair and quartz with this Labrador and Thomas Lacus. And Diamond, so he was actually very fond of teaching. In fact, he would bring out books to his classes at one school at chemistry folder. What are you trying to teach our students? They want to learn to trade.
And then the teacher would always check the gospel students and say, the same thing. Because when the student eye is big, and it got to be a little.
And Maurice still had, apparently, he did have always a couple of apprentices, but you had a shop, and then you had this little 3 square meter little place, and then you had another place with 4 workbenches, 2 for colleagues, and then 2 for apprentices.
Is this talking to you a little bit about the Soleil Ring, which is a long ring, and there's a wonderful video about it with Sophie LaFleur showing you how comfortable it is on the new website, which you can find in Soleil Ring.
It's completely flexible, and again, this idea of the hand, he felt that it was more elegant to have the length of the hand of the woman to be underlined, and it was also a possibility for him to go back to transparency.
And of course, this beloved point of
all
the
time.
Jean Vendome told us that the ball was really his favorite. And as Paul has been mentioning from the very beginning of the year, he was studying.
He was studying on the side of the drawing of sculpture, and he delves into sculpture. He did various sculptures, very sensible. The middle of it is sort of a figure, a stylized figure in bronze, and on the right is a satellite, and on the left is what he calls a sleeve. And it's a different technique. He uses different techniques. This is broken. This one is getting some of the bronze.
And what's the green? It's not
green. I think it's just passing
green.
So, again, he goes from the micro to the medium size.
And then, of course, he's a man, he's calling the engine calling the place. He sees things going on, making this design award, testing cars, testing people's own jewelry. So, I don't know what he's going on. He looks at that and he says, well, also, I mean, that's what he said, but I don't know what the story says. The techs were involved in making the Rubik's Cube. So let's make a Rubik's Cube jewel. Yes, indeed. It's a compact. You wear it as a pendant during the day. And then at night, you can take it apart, and all that cotton wool, all that stuff comes out, you can put it on. Don't start looking for them. Terry tells us to make several. It's sort of separate, right?
And that sort of has a necklace, a pendant, a brooch, earrings, and a ring. A bracelet. So it has like 5 different things, but apparently there's 21 different possibilities.
Like the Rubik's Cube.
Exactly.
So I want to know, I mean, if you just go on for a little bit, we have to stop at the book of Christian theme.
The story behind this piece is that he was so curious about it. He was in the market and he was admiring this beautiful cloud, which is a large cloud. And when he got it home in the evening, he had the idea to use one of the clouds as a job as to realize the whole thing. And he called it the tunnel knot, and he would fill the cloud with resin so that it could resist. And
most ones at the glass don't resist.
He combined this basic material with precious stones, semi with ornamental stones, with the first one of pearls. And it's actually kind of a fun way for him to show that there can be humor in jewelry.
And just quickly, that's what you would think was terrible. That's why I wanted to really delve into the picture of the lady wearing it. And then once again, I can't help myself, the design. Look at the design a little bit, and look at how exquisitely he designed all that movement. I mean, even if it's a couple of things that you look at that design and say, that's nice, but you can never make it. But he did make it. And it's not fragile. He did make it sturdy. And it can be more. That kind of nails all the topics. And another piece, the two.
This is the Tiki. The Tiki. So it's genetically spelled T-I-T-T-Y, and he used sea shells. And the sea shells have this natural design which looks like tikis. So tikis are made of peoples. And he of course, is extremely technically made. You can see it on the right. He's telling how each joint, the way it's going to move. And he combines this with these elements again, and the genetics of them. But the idea that, again, he's turning to nature, he's turning to all these, he looks at the industry, he looks at cars, he's really a man of all of the choices.
And when we zero in, we think it's pending. No, that's the stress.
That's the stress.
And then look at what he did with the different things. Look at how he took the actual shape of the chunky and turned that into a crystal. So amazing. We must pause at crystals before we conclude. Really just crystals, liberated to be crystals. Don't think once again it can be one because it is eminently wearable. Let's jump into this one, shall we? And see how it's very difficult. These stones are very difficult to work with. I know for a fact, having been a product manager in some of the great houses, that this ritual, of course, is a nightmare to work with, an absolute nightmare. And it's just an assembly that's so wonderful and so beautiful, right?
Well, what we're seeing here is this return to the natural crystal. He did not do anything to be you just put them in there and you just make it to work. And it's funny because friends said to yourself, this is not particularly serious. It's really, it is serious because you just did an author of a book, which is not available, but which you might talk about. She had a way of saying, and also there's some permission to it. She would say, she said that although started with the sound that built around the sound that we made right away, and this piece is actually written into this, and it's actually appended now, and so we feel like we want to look more at these pictures. We are taking these pictures from the exhibition database, but you can go further, just like we're doing here. You can jump further into those components with those high-def photos tied into each other. So we come to a period in Vendome's life, which is a very difficult. Earlier, we forgot to mention that in 1985 is when he lost reality. But then he's surging again. He comes back making the contract, going to international shows, etc. And in 1972-73, he had a very tragic bar collapse in his knee and his leg was extremely damaged. And it was a problem at the time, it did take his leg.
Early operations,
but it caught up with him, unfortunately. And in 1995-1996, he had added to his leg amputated. And he always saw the bright side. So what he did was to ask to help with his anesthetizer. He had his workbench set up, and he would work. And the nurses were mesmerized watching this brilliant man dry and working every day at
a jeweler's workbench in a hospital.
And he was extremely, it was painful, of course, and the doctor said that this piece on the far right is he never was told by his father that he believes it's showing the idea of his life having disappeared and the idea of the phantom pain with his parents on the courts at the bottom. It was an extremely painful experience, but then again, he turned into creativity.
Okay, beautiful. Yeah. And it's very at the same time.
Exactly.
Two brains, why not? That's another kind of, there's so much. And that's why we wanted to explore the examples of the linear marks of his life, these great exhibitions that happened. And from these great exhibitions, like this is a very special, it's something that Father did a catalog for. Something that Father was a young student who met him in his workshop, and he loved him, and he said, how about putting a book? And for 5 years, he taught her about jewelry.
He's not one of his homework, he was wearing his jewelry in all history class.
Yeah. So here at the Museum of Cultural Arts in Lyon, is this book that came about as a pretty major exhibition, the post exhibition at the Museum of Natural History. That was really, neurology was born at that museum. Neurology is born in France. And those are the landmarks in his life, too. The Mountain Fort, we don't know, we gave you a taste. Told and talking so beautifully about those nine chords. Maybe this topic, maybe the one about drama, the one about theater.
He did all these are different people politically, but there was an economist, yes, and this is actually where Rene de Obadiel was a writer. And on this, you see again the symbols, he made a specific coin for this person, and he incorporated the profiles of that coin onto the guard, and you have, again, these with pistols, you have the name of Obadiel's works, major works, incredible bronze measures. So again, he takes, and you have here the plume.
So if you want to know more about this, because we can't indulge our temptation, we'd like to tell you more. Kathleen Carney, I'll go to the article, which is available to be online at any time. At that point, we need to leave you, sadly, and we'd like to end work and begin with the design and result of the workshop. And in terms of all the design, the hand of the designers. Look at how most designers design on scale. But he designs monumentally. He makes the think of the whole A4 white sheet. He designs at home to relax. Number 30,000 pieces, the designs are uncountable. Quite a few gorgeous ones are donated to the Museum of Western Arts. You can find them in the database there, but they're uncountable. He would design at night. He would bring the design into the workshop in the morning. If it made it to the PI, to spread it, some of them will just spread it, throw it away. But if it made it, we went to the workshop the next morning, and this is the time period, and this picture is the time period when the stuff he used in his life, very important. He had two great muses, two great loves, and I knew that in 2004 comes into his life. And the designs are part of the family, and the piece might be lucky to get born into the Hey Jewel. Thing he did was to create a design. I had a dream, and so did his son. I had a dream. here's the design. And it was almost one of the last things he said. I had a dream of a flying fox. And once again, the hand of Jean Vendome there, the energy. This is, I mean, like, we're about to pass together life. And the energy, little crayon, he likes crayons and felt of things. He draw up this flying fox, and his son, through the hands of my Lyra, is handed to him, and his son,
it's fully comfortable, full circle, in a way like the instant connection of his drawing and then the taking of the promise of his friends to be in a very moving way. And of course, Jean Vendome left us in recent years, 2017, and as you can see, he was a person full of ideas. He spent 6 years in his life breaking the chains of convention and showing the appreciation of crystals and spells, and also everything that was done by hand and the importance of design. He was a real pioneer. Even to this day, his tools are close, plus the process in many ways that he's able to just look around. I was so lucky to get his friend. I can see that they still have impact and relevance today.
And many collectors who have known him and loved him as a community, kept him, they think about him, could be in a little workshop behind the store with him. They called it the cousin room, which was a little storage room, and then his voice would pipe up, and he'd come out and talk to the clients and say, that's what you want, I know what you want, here's a stone. Sometimes he even gave the clients stones. So these squares of passionate admirers of him are some of the 26 people who loaned the 120 pieces, 126 pieces, 120 something pieces that are here, that you can explore through the main site, through the gallery, hopefully up to May 8th coming back. Fingers and toes crossed. Thank you so much for being with us. These guys will be collecting for Paul and me for questions, which we'll take a look at in a minute. And before we do that, let's remember that our continuing gathering group will be gathering again with Olivia Sakura and with Elise James from the Museum of the Cobain on February 17th and 18th. Again, we have our tradition. The first is in the early evening in French, the next day, two in English. And then Inezita and Altamont and Lee McDonald, the curator of the Museum of Natural History, and the head of cultural history about the African jewels, in March. And at the end of March, Marie Moore and I are coming back to talk about this amazing, magical, mysterious metal topic. So tell us, let's take a look at what kind of questions do we have. Let's take a look. We have are all jewels and these pieces are good job of those in his series as well. He produced series of about 80% for unique pieces. So about 80% of that 30,000 was unique. He would do series like Ransom Sagadi, he did it about 50. And with 42 diamonds, probably 66, those are numbers you can't forget. And then he stopped.
It's important also to remember that, as we said several times, he wasn't doing producing and using molds, using etc. He was not doing the pieces were treated as if they were of each original.
I'm a long admirer of his photographer design. Is there any evidence of our types of tonal designs were influenced by the size and other kinds of photography palace that you might create a question on school? This is a man who said he couldn't do it without palace. This is a man whose love affair with Nelly was all about walking the pavement, the comment.
I think definitely. He was extremely in tune with many different photographers and many different painters. And of course, Maggie and I are so he was
I love this question. Native New Yorker, born there. Born just over the river, because I might have went out of the hospital to be moving for hospital. But did he ever sell his work in New York? Oh, let me tell you, Americans, hello, all the Americans, love Jean Vendome. He sold pieces all over America. There are American collectors everywhere. That one for sure I can answer. Even further on his practice, does he continue to use just rough drawings or do he use real text drawings? I love that! Those are his text drawings. I spent ages with Thierry Vendome and so did Paul looking at the drawings and discussing his visionary history. We love this. This is not two people sitting around trying to make this draw. These are his technical drawings. The piece was his baby. He played with it at night because he trapped himself in his pain. And then in the morning, the baby might make it or no. They'd say, no, not that one. Put it aside. If it made it, it made it because he cut it out. He took it to the workshop and showed it to everyone, and it got to be a jewel. No wax, no nonsense. From the design to the bench to
actually just work as we said earlier, he thought that the process, the shorter that time to start, the more immediate and beautiful the dream would be.
The more you know about him, the more amazing he is. Did you have any attention to carry on the book? Actually, there's a gentleman who was watching last night, who was with him for 35 years. I'm trying to think of the name, I'm thinking of it right now. But they learned from him, and they loved him, and he taught in his book. And Jean Vendome is like, is an original jeweler, an original artist like him. It's really like the tree that has another tree that has the same genetics but grows in its own creative way. Carry on the workshop. We can't get to all those questions. If you ask questions as messages on Instagram, we all will get to them. How rare is it to find these secret investments on the vintage jewelry market? Any idea of the price point? Price points can be depending on we love that we are teachers now, so we're not going to worry about price points. You can find them, Mr. Google will tell you, and the pieces do come up. Although, again, twice a week, what is longer, they don't talk with them very often, but you can find them.
Yes, I think that's the best choice for the original auction house is to acquire just kind of like the price. I think it's like getting a jewelry, it depends on the piece, but it could be a big piece that would be quite pricey and things that are quite
reasonable. Someone says, what shop galleries full? When he was alive, you went to him. And he was so non-commercial. He was so, that's exactly why when he was a teacher, I get that as a teacher. He taught every single person how many times a step brought the food. You know, when we have our children's workshop, I'm teaching the 6-year-olds how to do the Costco as far as I'm concerned. That's the way it is. You taught them to go for the top, go for this place. And he could have done so much commercial that he didn't do. And that's one of the nicest things about this person, right?
Well, he did have collaborations with Paradis.
Yes,
of course, but as a business did. He sold his work himself, and as we said, he was up those days where the jewelry stores every year. So he just worked on all of the others as well.
I think we're going to stop because we need to respect our children, especially since we have Christmas and everything here. Keep talking to us. Keep continuing with us. We have put the Instagram and website and all the handles there because for us, that's our continuing to go further to change the platform. Right, Paul?
Yes, and we will get back to you. It's always so frustrating because spreading the right questions means there's a lot of interest. So thank you all so much. It's been very moving to be here and to deal with these beautiful jewels. And talking about such a great monument for the 20th century.